Hello, everybody, and welcome to the first, and possibly only, depending on how this goes, to the first of Aquablade11 podcast, I guess. Maybe it has a have an official name or something, but a video where I gather a group of people and we talk about something. This is something that usually I don't have enough time to fully discuss in detail in recordings or other videos. So here are the people that I have here with me, which are all mods of mine, and they've all been a guest at least once in the past. So, I guess I'll go down the line, and everyone, you can just all introduce yourselves, in, you know, in the order that you guys are on Discord right now, top to bottom.
Hi, I'm Captain Manette. I've appeared. I was the only guest in the Ultra Sun and Moon playthrough on his channel, and I usually have a lot to say about games because I'm going into game development and it's a huge passion of mine, so I'll probably be talking a lot.
Yeah. I've noticed that as a recurring thing. That's all right.
Is it my turn? Okay. Yes. I'm Sir Pex Nessie, and I was in that one episode of Crystal Wedlock, I think.
Yes.
with a bunch of people. With a crap ton of other people in it. So I guess that technically counts, right?
It does. I feel like you were one of the ones who talked the most. So if I remember it correctly, I feel like so you're at least somewhat memorable, in my opinion, from that.
I like talking.
So, and then Jolt.
Okay, I am Sir Joltion. I was in the Crystal Wedlock. I was in the mess of an episode towards the end, and I was also in the Elite Four episodes. And hopefully I will have...
Okay, and then lastly, Pip, he's been in a lot.
Hey, it's me, the Pidgeotto Killer and the Spreader of Viruses and the Aquablade Twitch.
Yeah, he's basically a meme in many different ways with all the different stuff I do, but...
Blame Pip! Fire's Pip! Yeah, there's a ton of memes.
Yes, I don't
and
know if...
He's also the world's number one Crobat hater.
Yes, that too.
Yep. Hey, anybody who's listening who draws art at all, you know the penguin from Batman? Well, Piptina's thing is literally a penguin. He's a Piplup, so you should just draw him as the penguin, and it would be perfect, because he likes to kill the bat.
Huh, okay.
Yep. I feel like that was mentioned at one point. You can't tell if you guys can see his icon or how close it's zoomed in, but his icon is right now a thing he drew that's supposed to be his icon looking like glitchy and stuff to be a Pip virus, basically. So, which is also a recent emote I've added in my Discord, along with several others that people kept demanding just yesterday, actually, as of the day recording this.
I haven't added the sting emote at the time of this recording.
Yes, I didn't get around to that one. But anyway, on to what we're actually talking about today. We're talking about Ultra Sun, Ultra Moon. Because while I did talk a lot about it in my Blind Nuzlocke, I feel like I didn't do a great job at explaining everything because I was just constantly complaining about stuff, which admittedly I feel like wasn't a great idea.
So.
What? What was that?
Rightfully so.
Rightfully so. All right.
Oh.
So, and also, I'm totally free if you guys feel like debating, if you guys differing opinions on certain stuff in the game. Because, for example, I already know that Serp unironically likes Rotom. So.
Yeah.
So, which is fine. So I have nothing against any of that. So that is all we're going to do. But first topic I have on my list is my Nuzlocke itself. Because... I guess I just want to hear what you guys thought of it in terms of both a playthrough, in terms of like the quality of a playthrough, and like a Nuzlocke, things like that. Because there were quite a bit of complaints about it, and a lot of them were very valid. I wanted to see what you guys think about it. Mm. You guys can just talk spontaneously, or if you want to go in a sequential order down the line we just did, if you want to make it more organized, I don't care either way, personally.
Let's do this in sequential order so everyone can be heard.
Sure, but also people are free to interject if they'd like as well. So,
okay.
Objection.
So, yes.
Bold. Just thoughts on your playthrough of it then, or?
Yeah, just my play that did it. Like in terms of my narration quality and I guess Nuzlocke ability and how good I did it. Oh.
I thought it was okay. I thought it was.
Feel free to be really harsh if you want.
It was a pretty standard. I mean, you did complain a lot, but I usually agree with you, so I think that kind of colors my bias of that.
Okay.
I don't know. I found it amusing. I never miss an episode. I always watch when I went up, so I definitely enjoyed it. It wasn't a slog. So, mm-hmm. I felt like there was one thing I did want to say about it. You didn't make that many mistakes. You made a couple of dumb mistakes.
I always do.
Yeah. I felt like you made like one or two more than usual in it. But
okay.
That's about it.
Okay, cool.
What was I gonna say? I was Well, you are really good at Nuzlocks.
Oh, well, thank you.
Like, no, I'm pretty sure, like, no one had any faith in you.
No, no one does. No, they never do.
Yeah.
So, I did.
That was a thing.
Yeah, spoiler, I win the Nuzlocke. So, yeah, if you haven't watched it.
Gasp. Yeah, like, I've never gotten past, like, the second gym of any Nuzlocke, so.
Yeah. Okay, good. Fair. Yeah, that's one thing I feel like I did a decent job in terms of it being a challenge. I just don't feel like I did very well in terms of narrating and making it entertaining.
I mean, I can't really judge your nuzlocking skills because I'm the only one probably in this Discord that hasn't done a nuzlock yet. I hope to change that soon. But I thought your play, I thought the LP was pretty average, I guess. Obviously, I think the complaining 24/7 was the biggest issue.
Yeah, it was. You don't have to be.
I don't need to. I don't need to go further into detail on that. I'm glad that Zimbato was the survivor.
Oh, yeah.
I'm pretty sure I suggested that name, actually.
You suggested Zimbato? Maybe. I know you suggested Makoweedle, right? I think you did. Yeah.
I suggested using him.
Yeah, you suggested using Zimbato, yeah, in the episode you were in. I was going to use Castain, the Wishy-Washy, instead. I don't think he would have done as well.
Oh, yeah, you never used that Lycanroc.
No, yeah. I didn't.
And you never caught anything at Blush Mountain.
That Lycanroc is still in my PC box, too.
Okay, I was sure you were going to replace Tyrantrum with the Lycanroc, but...
Yeah, I guess I just thought maybe Rock wouldn't be all that great for the types that are in the Elite Four, but...
Before we get too off, Pip, what did you think?
What I think about his Nuzlocke?
Yeah.
Basically, one thing that always bugged me was your complaints. I mean, I can understand your complaints are justified, but sometimes it messes with your immersion. You really could have saved a lot of lives in that Ribombi fight if you were thinking ahead.
The Ribombi fight? Oh. Yeah. Okay. I feel like for what it was worth, I did okay. Like, with the toxic.
He would have lost somebody else had I not been there.
And also the fact he didn't pay attention when his Gramble died.
My Gramble, what? Oh, wait, against Mulane. Okay, but whoever I switched to would have been hit by a Z move from the steel thing. I think they would have might have died instead, or at least done a big chunk to them. I think.
No, the person you ended up using would have survived anyways. Can't remember who it was. I remember because I did check that.
I used Foil at the end. Yeah, because it was then Metagross was out. Naganadel died to him, and then I switched to Foil Nagazone, who killed him off, so...
You could have switched to Foil immediately for Metagross.
I could have gotten through without Naganadel dying, but I kind of wanted him to die off because I felt like he was a little overpowered. I wanted to win without him, so.
Yeah, because and one thing too was that Hal fight. That was a really, really good fight.
Yes, I agree. I'm glad you thought so. Anyway, specifically about my complaining that I thought was when you're rewatching when I was editing everything is the thing that I kept saying. Was I constantly said, this is the same game. I said that line a lot. And the reason I did is because there was a point where I was told that the game would start getting different from this point on. So I patiently waited for that to get different, and it never really did. So that's why I kept saying that. But in retrospect, no, that it wasn't a good idea to keep saying that, because it looked like I was just upset that I was doing repeat playthrough or something.
I think you shouldn't have even really listened to those.
I really shouldn't have. You're right. Which brings me to the other point about Ultra Necrozma. My God, that had a ton of dislikes on it, a ton of angry comments, basically saying.
I wonder from who gave you a certain idea.
Hello, it's his eye.
But yeah, people were like, oh my God, this isn't a blind playthrough. You know exactly what to do.
Hey, well, to be fair, everyone told me that it was going to be really difficult, too.
Yeah, I know. I mean, what was I supposed to do? Not listen and then pretend I didn't hear anything? And, like, because I'm not going to lie and say, oh, I have no idea what's going on, and then act like something is surprising. I wouldn't want to do that, so.
I mean, in my opinion, I think, like, analyzing your team at a time, I don't think he would have been swept anyways had he gone in without any different preparation.
Really?
I think he would have lost. I think he would have lost four members to him. I think I had decided that you would have been able to get had you not been stupid. If you had made stupid mistakes, he might have gotten swept.
Sure.
But if you had actually thought about it.
Right, because like Makuhita could do a first impression, do a ton of damage.
Yeah.
I don't remember offhand the rest of my Pokemon, but.
Your Trevenant, I thought would have been able to do it because I felt like you would immediately realize how strong it is. And send in your Trevenant to do something, and then whittle it down after that one first impression. And you'd
probably try to curse it. Probably, yeah.
You'd probably go through like three members from the first impression, and then the curse, and then you would have still been fine.
Okay.
Or he could be me and freeze Ultra Necro.
Hello.
What?
He cut out.
Did he cut out? Okay.
Yeah. He cut out.
Did I cut out?
Yeah. I heard what you said. Freeze Ultra. So I knew what you were going to say, but...
Well, I guess he literally froze.
Yeah. Yeah, I froze Ultra Necrozma.
And nice. Yourself.
Personally, it was a fun fight for me. I lost my Gyarados to him, which was really sad. But I think I had two deaths in that fight.
I just soloed it with Toxapex.
Yeah.
He was the one I got the idea from, but I mean, I don't know what else I would have done, honestly. I already did anticipate it was going to be a difficult battle. I just thought of what on my team I could do to make sure I try to have as few deaths as possible. And I thought probably Toxic or Curse. If I curse, though, chances are I'll lose Trevenant. So I went with Toxic instead, with Focus Sash. So...
For me, I lost twice to Ultra Necrozma, but then the third time, because, you know, third time's a charm, I was lucky with my Totem Togedemaru to get the Nuzzle Zingzap Paraflinch.
Oh, nice.
Oh.
Okay.
To be fair, that attempt in which I froze Ultra Necrozma was not my first. And I did manage to get a Topsy-Turvy on it. That probably helped.
Oh, that's not a bad strategy at all, actually. Yeah.
I've heard lots of people using Toxic Topsy-Turvy just to go through the regular totem fights, too, because you can get a, what's-its-face in the beginning of the game.
NK,
yes.
Yeah, you could. That's actually a very good strategy.
I want to use one anyway, so...
I was so excited.
I considered using one, but...
And, it was a little disappointing compared to my other Pokemon, especially because I would occasionally use X items, and I couldn't use X items on it.
Who uses X items, but you don't?
Me. I do. I try not to overdo them.
Oh, you use X items during battle. Okay, I see.
Yes.
All right.
So Malamar, actually, forcing myself to use Malamar was a bit of a torture, because I could not use X items on it. It would nerf it.
I guess that makes sense, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I can see that.
That was fun. By the way, guys, I'd just like to point out, I found that this is my favorite nickname, maybe for anything. If any of you have played Phantom Hourglass, the main villain is this dark, evil, upside-down squid named Bellum, which was literally the perfect name ever for a Malamar. So I'm naming of my Malamars Bellum from now on.
I'm not familiar with the DS Zelda games, so I didn't know that. But that does sound like a good name.
I have Phantom Hourglass sitting literally right next to me.
Oh, please.
I got Spirit Tracks.
So there's room.
Okay. All right. Well,
I don't like it.
I guess this is a good transition because Ultra Necrozma was basically the one big new thing of the actual story, which replaced Lusamine, which is the next topic I'd like to discuss. I thought she was complete garbage in this game.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yep. No contest.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Everyone agrees. Should we move on or should we go into detail?
Well, you want to talk about why we think she's garbage? In case
probably, or else people just get mad. But people get mad anyway. It's fine.
Yeah.
I guess to me, it was just like her original arc was that she was just some like crazy cuckoo lady who wants to release the Ultra Beasts and release for some reason because you want the love and care for them, and then she doesn't care if they destroy the world. She just wants the love and care for them. But it changes to she wants to stop Necrozma, which. Okay, we all want to stop Necrozma. He's evil, but the only reason we have to stop her is because she's going to die because she's an idiot to try to fight Ultra Necrozma. But like I don't feel like I should care for her. Why should I care that this idiot lady is doing this thing? I can understand why Lily and Gladion sort of care, but I don't know.
Plus the fact that she was trying Cosmog to go do it.
Right, and there was even that scene that I rewatched the scene when I was editing, but like she like pushes a button and the computer is like, "Oh, why is Nebby not opening the wormhole? Oh, no, stop, Mom, don't go in." You know what? I'll prove to you that I can go in. I'll fight this I'll fight Aquablade11 or whatever your guys' trainer's name is. We fight her, we beat her. She's like, "Oh, I lost. I'll do it anyway." And so fighting her was no purpose at all. And then she pushes more buttons on the computer and then the wormhole does open that time. So I just found that really stupid. Regardless of the reason for why it happened, I found it really stupid.
They could have framed that whole scenario differently. Because at the time, Lily is very reliant on you. She's not reliant on her mother anymore. I think Lucimine would take great issue with that. She's such an incredibly controlling person. So if they had actually managed to convey the fact that Lucimine wants to beat you to sort of prove to herself that she was better than you and to try to like prove in some twisted way to Lily that like she's better than you.
Right.
It could have actually been a piece of writing. What we got wasn't even writing. I wouldn't even call that writing. It was just things to serve a game.
Maybe it would have made more sense if you actually got swept against Lusamine in Ultra Sun instead of Regular Sun.
It would have, actually.
Oh my god.
She's like, "See, I beat him. I will be just fine." I wonder if that's what the cut... I wonder if what happens, to be honest. Because, you know, in the first Sun, yeah, the cutscene continues as if you beat her, so...
What would be a crazy thought, guys, is if because of that, Lily doesn't have a transformation because she's so taken aback, and then the plot actually changes because of something that you did because you lost. Could you imagine?
That would be very interesting.
That would happen in Pokemon. Yes.
Do that for Gen 8 Pokemon.
The technology's not there yet.
Technology's there. I just don't know if Game Freak has it in to do something like that.
Yeah, imagine if there was a forced loss battle in Pokemon.
I mean, there have been.
I know there's one in some fan games, but not...
There's one... Isn't there one in the GameCube games? I'm pretty sure there's one in the GameCube games.
I think there is actually one in XDGL Darkness.
Yes. When you fight, what's his name? Zook or whatever the first time. He's like this bully guy. He has this shadow Zangoose that's like twice your level. And you just lose. And then this guy... who's actually a cool character, because those games actually have cool characters, comes and saves your butt. So.
Okay, anyone have anything to add about to Lusamine, or are we done with that one?
I think that's, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, about Lusamine.
Okay, yeah. Up next, I got the next lower tier of villains, Team Skull and Guzma.
Love them.
You love them? Oh, please explain.
Well, I one thing I hate is how they changed it in Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon with the first interaction with Team Skull where, oh my god, they're actually a threat, rather than they didn't care for them in Sun.
Agree 100%. That's like my biggest disappointment.
So, just hate Team Skull and Guzma. Same for Guzma. Plumeria, on the other hand, did she really change that much?
So are you say you do like them or a lot or
I like them all except for Plumeria. Her mainly because of how she treats her little brothers. I mean, I respect that a whole lot, but then there's this whole debate on how they all started out.
I feel like that they could have had it both ways with Team Skull. And they really didn't. Instead, they went no way. They literally, it was just bad. Because in the first game, you could ignore them. And because there was always dialogue options to not take them seriously. But there were also dialogue options to take them seriously. But they didn't have too much effect on anything, on the dialogue. In this game, I feel like they could have just made those things where you took them seriously actually give them their motive of, oh, we want to mess up trial goers. And that would have worked, because then you could have had the option where the dialogue would change and the game itself wouldn't change at all, because I know they'll never do that. The dialogue could have changed where you could have not taken them seriously, then no one takes them seriously, and you just have fun with that. Or if you want to treat them seriously, you can actually find out what their motives are, and they could have actually delved into that a little bit.
I think it would have worked better if Guzma was the one who wanted to defeat Necrozma instead of Lusamine.
Eh.
I feel like they didn't delve into Uzma and Plumeria and Team Skull enough, because they had so many things going on in these games and nothing happens with any of it.
Yeah, exactly.
And, that's my big, mm-hmm. and they added another one in Ultra Sun and Moon with the Ultra Recon Squad, and that also has nothing to happen with it.
Yeah.
It's just 6 hours. Yes, the cutscenes in this game are 6 hours if you go a little slow. It's still 4 or 5 hours if you go
really long. Six?
Yeah, it's 6 hours. So, of just stuff that happens, and none of it is ever interesting. Nobody tell Angry Joe.
Oh,
none
God.
None of it's ever interesting. So, that was a very long tangent. The point is, they could have gone more with Team Skull if they actually just wanted to develop them. They could have had it both ways. And they could have had Guzma and his backstory with Kukui and Plumeria. We could have actually learned about them as characters and why they are the way they are a little bit more than what we did. And just a little bit more, I think, would have gone a long, long way.
Right. Yeah, I feel like they're just kind of pointless in this game overall. I feel like they're just kind of there as just more trainers to fight. For no real reason except they're just the evil team to fight, which is unfortunate because I did like them. I just really got sick of them after a while. So
yeah,
I will say that they are still. Sorry.
No, right, Serp, you haven't said anything yet.
Really. Yeah, I will still say that they are still better than a lot of other evil teams.
Team Plasma.
Well, at least in the first time, entertainment value.
They had more character than the other teams, but I think they didn't really try to give any character to other teams. They just kind of were things that happened. It's part of a shift in focus in these games is they're trying more with the plot, but the plot isn't any good, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
In my opinion, anyways.
It's just more stuff. It just doesn't lead to anything major.
Yeah, and some of it's charming. It's definitely charming. I know the first time you played it, AB, you were swept away by how charming Team Skull were.
Oh, yeah. I like in Sun and Moon, I thought they were funny. I thought they were hilarious. I liked running into them.
And there's a lot of charm in these games. There's a ton of it. In all little character interactions, they really put a lot of heart into little things in this game. Mm-hmm. But there's no substance. It's just all charm.
I guess that kind of brings me to a different topic I have, unless anyone has anything else to say about Team Skull before I move on.
One thing I got to say, sure. I missed the yellow stupid line from Guzma.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, that.
All right. I'm going out of order of my list, but this seems more like a good transition to this one. You said a lot of the things they added were small and menial. A lot of the thing, this is kind of differences between Sun and Moon and Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon. Because I said earlier that I kept complaining that it was the same game, which, to be fair, I feel like it kind of was, but that doesn't justify me constantly saying it. But I did seriously think it was. But a lot of people commented like saying, no, there's a lot of small things that are new and a lot of side questy bone extra stuff that's new and different. And I guess my first thought on that is, I guess that's fine. It's just not what I care about for a Pokemon game. I care about the actual meat of the game, not the extra random stuff. But I guess what are you guys' thoughts on differences and additions and if it was enough and if you, I don't know, things like that.
I think that brings us overall to the point of these sort of third or was two of them, but sort of extra installments with each generation. Because they've existed since Gen 1, but Gen 1 had Yellow, which was significantly different. It was based on the anime. Gen 2 had Crystal, but Crystal actually changed a lot. They added a lot more to that. They added a new character you could play as. You could play as a girl for the first time.
Plus the anime sprites.
The thing is as time goes on, these third things really just fix just plain issues that the first game had. For example, Diamond Pearl Platinum. Platinum literally just made the game 100%
I'll never play
better.
Diamond or Pearl again because of that.
They're just to fill a gap with very easy development that a smaller team can work on to tie over the team and just make them a lot more money. But in this day and age, we don't need to go out and buy a whole new thing to update our game. We can just get an update. So they're sort of obsolete. All the changes in Ultra Sun and Moon either didn't need to happen because they made the game worse. The other ones that made the game better could have been DLC.
Right, but why do DLC when you can sell the game again?
Yeah, and make a lot more money.
Right, so.
So it's really just a cash grab at that point. They're not different games because they aren't meant to be different games. They're meant to just make Game Freak and Nintendo more money. It's just a business thing.
It is the bottom line. I can't really personally blame them for that, but it definitely says a lot about the quality of the game, in my personal opinion.
Yeah.
All right. Sir, anything?
Well, I don't think it justified the $50, though.
Okay. That's all?
Yes.
Yeah, I got nothing.
Yeah, essentially.
I would like to point out that...
Oh, am I?
It was at least heavily rumored. I think it was confirmed, but I couldn't find where I'd heard that confirmed. It was from a source I actually trusted, so I still think it's true. Ultra Sun and Moon was supposed to originally be on the Switch, but because it's supposed to be system sales for the end of the year, because Nintendo thought the Switch was going to flop for most of the year and that they were going to need system sales by the end of the year. But they transitioned the development back to the 3DS when the Switch just boomed the instant it launched. So if I could see why these would be fine transitional games to the Switch.
Really? Okay. I feel like I would have liked them less if they were on the Switch, because that would have made me think, oh, cool, new games for the next system? Oh, these, but no, they're still the same game. They're just on
My reasoning behind that is having them be on a more powerful system would literally fix, like, half the issues with this game.
Like skippable cutscenes?
Skippable cutscenes.
That was all I needed.
faster loading times overall. Not lagging when you have more than two Pokemon on the screen at any point in time.
Right.
Just things like that. And just the fact that it looks nice. And it's something people...
Yeah, we got Pokemon falling behind us.
Oh, Pokemon falling... Yeah.
Maybe. I mean, oh, yeah.
That's just icing on the cake. But they actually could have... made more changes even if they were working with a Switch than with this. So sure. Maybe that was just a rumor, but had that been true, I think I would have been okay with purchasing these games on the Switch. I would be less irritated.
Okay.
I'm not convinced that's true. I don't think Nintendo would think their own systems are going to fail them.
They flat out say that.
Do they?
Yeah, they literally did. I know that for a fact. They literally said that they thought that the Switch was going to sell like a fifth of what it actually did, or something silly. Even the stretch goal for the year, like the peak of this is the best case scenario, was still like a third of what it actually sold or something. So that's why they couldn't sell it. That's why it was completely out of stock for almost a full year. It's because they just couldn't keep up production because they didn't think they're gonna have that much, and they couldn't increase the contract because the company had contracts with other companies for the same parts, and you can't just expand your contract like that. So
I guess because of they were just going off. Maybe they were just basing it on Wii U sales, thinking they like, were, oh. Okay, then yeah, that's understandable.
Because after the Wii U, they were really stubborn. Because they thought the Wii U was going to do a lot better than it did. And when that flopped, they lowered their expectations a lot, basically.
Okay, that makes sense to me. But I guess, so the new things, though, in general, were they... I guess you guys seemed to be all in agreement that they didn't justify a brand new game, but were they at least good things in general? Or I like Mantine games. Surfing.
I think the Pokemon Squad
were ham-fisted in, and so were all of the different little plot changes. But I think all the mechanical improvements they made were good. A couple of the loading times were like a second faster, which was fine. They did optimize things slightly, but for the most part, they were just kind of, I don't know. Yeah, Mantine Surfing was fun.
I liked the Ultra Recon Squad, even though they really didn't have to be there. I liked them.
They were charming, as I said before. They were charming, but they were kind of ham-fisted.
Yeah, I wish there was more to them. I feel like they had a lot of potential as well. Like,
Dolph's was. Zossi less so.
There's an entire subreddit dedicated to just Zossi. People are obsessed with
her. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
She is.
They said in the memes chat earlier today.
Well, she has a lolly.
Okay, let's not get into that here.
If we could explore more of Ultra Megalopolix. Is that one area?
Is you walk in, climb a tower, fight Ultra Necrozma, and leave.
People, I don't remember if it was in this Discord or a different Discord, who was saying that was a fantastic thing. I was like, what are you talking about? They said that it was a good thing that the area was so small, because that's all you wanted to do was go there and fight Necrozma. That's it. They didn't want any extra. They called it like filler or something. This was when the free games first came out, so I won't be able to find it now. But whoever you are,
Ultra.
You're insane. literally justify less content in the game.
Yeah, why add new dimensions of all things if you're not going to do anything?
Yeah.
I would love to explore Ultra Megalopolis, or imagine if they had an extra route north Ultra Megalopolis in their area.
I think that's ultra, like the, what are they called? The wormholes?
Ultra Space Wilds?
That area?
Yep.
And from what I've seen, I haven't actually played it into post-game, they did actually add some cool things with that. Like, there are legitimate whole entire areas. Like, there's an alternate version of one of the towns of the game that's a completely abandoned and torn apart into a girls' wall is.
Yes, I've seen that.
Yeah.
There's several areas like that. I think that's fantastic. In fact, you know what I would be happy with? It would be cool if they added more areas to that as, like, $2 DLCs. That's a way they could make a lot of money, and I would actually be okay with that because it's brand new content that's actually interesting to explore and to fight new Pokemon. Maybe that's how we're going to fight that one new electric furry thing.
The aura?
Oh, yeah.
Zerowra.
I still don't know what that thing does.
I guess that's a good transition to the next topic. New Pokemon and just new... I guess this is combined a couple topics, but... Like, new Pokemon they added just for Ultra Sun, Ultra Moon. That's the first time they've done that, in the middle of a generation. I did, along with different Pokemon just in the region compared to Sun and Moon, as well as the new and improved shiny rates in the Ultra Wormholes. This is just capturing Pokemon topic, I guess. Which I thought all good things, except I don't care at all about post-game stuff, so shiny rate thing actually doesn't really affect me at all, but... I personally don't like it because the higher the chance of finding a shiny, the less valuable it is, in my opinion.
I think it was bumped to every fifth wormhole, if you're lucky, has a shiny. Because there was a moment where I got a shiny Lombre, then the next wormhole I encountered a shiny Altaria, which sadly died because of freaking Parish Song.
No.
I heard they made it a 1 in 3 chance of finding a shiny.
I think it would be okay, because it's always been very luck based and it's always been very special to find it in the game. I think it should stay that way in terms of the main game. But if you're in post game, I feel like you should have had to do more in the post game to be able to earn that right where you can get shinies a little easier. Because in competitive battling, people love their perfect teams, and so if you have 100 everything, if you've completed everything, you've reached that point where you could probably deserve to have higher chance of getting shinies, but maybe have them work for that right as opposed to just giving it to you so easily.
Yeah, I can see that.
It's kind of like a shiny charm after completing the national dex. Combine that with being able to access these new shinies in the
what game is that? The shiny charm. Is that in this
game? Fifth gen onward, I believe.
Fifth gen.
I think that's a fantastic idea. I honestly think that's how it should be.
Okay.
Now, certainly someone here didn't need Ultra Wormhole to get his first shiny.
Speaking of shinies, I'm just bragging here, but like the second but near I found in the entire game was shiny.
I think that's who he was talking about. Yeah, you.
Yeah.
I've only ever found two shinies.
My Baneary ended up being male.
And in ROMs, I found my fair share of shinies, but in terms of cartridges, like physical games, I've only found two shinies, and I found them within the same week. It was crazy. I wasn't even playing a lot at the time. I literally booted up this game like 3 times that week, and on the first and third time, I got a shiny both times.
Nice.
This is when I was like 7. It was the first time I ever saw sand shinies. I didn't even know they existed before then.
Wow.
You know about the red Gyarados?
I don't think that counts.
Now that we've all shared fun stories about that, you mentioned the changes that they made to this game overall. The biggest clincher in terms of this game, these games being better than Sun and Moon, is the fact that they changed
that
the way
we were talking
Pokemon
about?
Spawn at.
Just encountering Pokemon, capturing Pokemon in general with subtopics.
The fact that you can get more diverse Pokemon in this game as opposed to Raticate, Gumshoes, and Pelipper every single route.
They still are though on every route.
The chance is much that they aren't on every route anymore. They took them off of like half the routes they were on before. It might feel like that.
Okay.
I feel like you as Nuzlocking just got bad luck with some of the Pokemon you got early on. So in some of the later routes where they were on those routes, you just kept running into them over and over again trying to find a new Pokemon.
I guess that makes sense.
For me personally, I found each of them like once and I never really had an issue with just running into him again and again and again and again trying to get a new Pokemon, which I did in the first games a lot. And I did a direct comparison of the routes for the games afterwards, and yeah, they are on a lot less routes.
I think in regards to the Alola decks as a whole, I mean, like you, AB, I'm not a big fan of large Pokedex sizes, but I can kind of forgive it because it's Pokemon 20th, and I do think it is a very solid Pokedex overall. Oh, I like it better too, than X and Y's at least.
Right, I do like it as well. The I guess it when I didn't like it at first in Sun and Moon was because I didn't like it when you introduce so few new ones and then overload with old ones. It takes focus away from the new ones. At least for me, when I catch stuff randomly.
And the fact that no trainer had Minior or Araquanid, or Lana did have Araquanid in Sun and Moon, but
yeah, she's optional.
Yeah, I didn't. I went like almost the whole time knowing you couldn't even. I didn't talk to her again until the after game.
I actually did not know
she had like level 25 Pokemon.
Right.
In regards to the expanded decks in Ultra Sun, Ultra Moon, I think they added a lot of good additions, like Tropius, because Tropius really fits the region of Alola. Some not so much, like, I don't know.
Yeah. I'm so salty they didn't add Blossom.
Yeah. And, Blossom? And yeah. Especially Lunatone and Solrock.
Oh, yeah. Hey,
that was dumb.
Yeah, that was me.
They had 100 new Pokemon to Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon, but not the actual Pokemon that are shaped like the Sun and Moon.
Or, you know, the Hula Dancer.
Right.
I think overall it was definitely better, but the fact that you still can't get Riolu and Lucario until post-game makes it a 0 out of 10.
Oh, that reminds me. I feel like someone at one point told me that I could catch a Totodile somewhere. But
yeah, you can.
Oh, yeah, Island Scan.
Do Island Scan.
Yeah, I don't even know what... I gotta be honest, I don't even know what that is. I've never used that before.
Me neither.
Me neither.
Isn't it like the thing from ORAS? Didn't ORAS basically have that? Except it
no,
was...
it's different than that. Basically, the Island Scan, you scan random QR codes that you find around. And
oh, yeah. I forgot about that. Oh.
At certain, it's only at certain locations you encounter special Pokemon like Honedge, Shinx, or the starters.
No, I remember that now. I considered using it, but I decided to like ban it for myself during the Nuzlocke.
I was just too lazy to bother with it.
Yeah, me too.
I didn't use it either, but that's all my Pokemon War stuff I can just find naturally in my final team.
Any other comments on that, or should we move on?
Well, we didn't even talk about the new Pokemon.
Oh my god, you're right.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's amazing that they added new Pokemon mid-generation.
Yeah.
I was super surprised when we saw Blacephalon in the Nintendo Direct.
I feel like we could have gotten more Alola forms.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Yeah.
Especially ones that weren't Kanto.
Cough, Blossom, cough.
Yeah, I think it would have been really neat had they just gone straight to Gen 2.
Stunfisk. Rock Poison type Stunfisk, make it happen.
No, I feel I would have been happiest with one of two things. I can't use it. This is a PG channel. Had they just gone ahead and
I can
done Gen 1 again, with I would have been a little disappointed because they just did a bunch of Gen 1 stuff and they really like enjoy. Okay, I can't use any analogies. I have a dirty mind. So
I think I know what you're gonna say. It's fine.
So. If I had it done second gen, which is coming up with its anniversary in you know, a couple years or whatever, they did just release Crystal on the Virtual Console, it would have coincided with that. Or, because we all know that freaking fourth gen's coming around again because they're hinting so many damn things with that.
Yeah.
They could have done fourth gen, yeah, I don't really want it either, but I'm okay with it. As long as they're good games, I'm okay with it. It's still Pokemon. I'm not going to say, don't give me another Pokemon game.
I'll still buy it. It's just not something I'm going to ask for.
But had they given forms to 4th gen Pokemon, I would have been okay with that, especially because I like a lot of 4th gen Pokemon. It's basically my favorite thing about the 4th generation is a lot of the Pokemon in it. Alolan Lucario could have been amazing.
It would have been pandering.
You really like Lucario, huh?
Wait a second. That's it. That's exactly what Zamoa is. It's just a lowly Lucario. They've had a clear damn fiddle on his guys. That's what it is.
Really?
I figured out game theory. Someone called Matt Pat. Someone call him right now.
I guess I kind of see the resemblance now that you mention that.
But, yeah.
But hey, that's just a theory. More of a dog.
And Zora's more of a cat.
Yeah, Zora's. Someone did a mod hack and they recolored Ryuki, the optional boss trainer that appeared battling the Elite Four as a champion. And someone recolored him to look like Zora.
Okay.
Was that the Stars one?
Ryuki's the one that had all the dragons.
No, the hack you're talking about. Was that Pokemon Stars? Somebody made Pokemon Stars. Okay. The game is so ridiculous. Was it made by the same people who made Tyranitar tubes, like, things?
Yeah, I think it
okay,
was.
Okay, I figured. Cool. I figured, because I saw some of that. I'm like, this smells very similar. You guys haven't seen Tyranitar tubes playthroughs of...
I have no idea what you're talking about.
...and whatnot. They're weird. They're okay. Sometimes they're genuinely amazing, but other times it's just like, what? Why?
Believe the Pico.
These people with so much talent with modifying these games just need a good writer so they can actually go make Pokemon games that are really good. Because they put so much effort in, and it's just so weird.
Anyone else have any more comments on the new Pokemon added?
I do. You go first, sir.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Blacephalon basically invalidates Chandelure as a ghost fire type.
Yeah.
It invalidates.
It's basically better Chandelure.
Except it doesn't look as cool. It looks like a clown.
Yeah, I like clowns.
When I first saw
I think it's weird how Naginadel is essentially... That's how I pronounce it. Like, I think Nadel's supposed to be like needle.
I'm sure it is. I probably pronounce it wrong.
It's officially pronounced Naginadel.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's officially pronounced Naginadel.
Did they say that in the anime?
Has it appeared yet? It's
not yet.
New.
Poipole's appear in the anime, but not Naginadel yet.
Well, how do we know if that's the official pronunciation?
Well, I give zero craps about...
Nadal is German for needle. It's a German name.
Whatever. But it looks like I can't help but think of Mega Beedrill when I see it.
Yeah, I know.
I did think of that, kind of, yeah.
Yeah, I thought that
and
was
it's weird how it's got a giant needle on its abdomen, but it's specially based.
Guys, you know what this means, right? It means it's an Alolan Mega form. That's what it is.
Oh, boy.
A game theory? No.
When I first saw Poipole, I knew I wanted to at least have it on my team because I knew it had more potential. Similar to how when I first saw Wimpod, I wanted to add it on my team. Or Gluzzpod was a thing.
I do really Poipole as a... I mean, it's literally a purple Pokemon named Poipole, and I love the color purple. But I do think it's a really cool-looking, cute thing. I feel like Naginadel is a little uninspired, just looking like Ultra Beedrill, but I feel like there's a lot of potential there that Naginadel could have been like one of my favorite Pokemon.
But do the Ultra Beasts count as legendaries?
Oh no.
It doesn't matter. Honestly, what difference does it make? Does it make any difference at all?
I don't think it
they
don't
really
think
blurred
difference.
The lines with this generation on what the term legendary means.
They have, for example, Silvally is officially a legendary somehow.
Yeah, and Titanol is not.
So, in other words, who cares? We don't know. It doesn't matter. They're just Pokemon. So, anyway.
Nice. Did you know this changes the entire context of the game? Naginadel's speed stat of 121 is the only base stat of an Ultra Beast that isn't a prime number. What does this mean? Who thinks of this?
Someone really... Okay. Okay. All right, let's move on to the next topic. This is getting old.
Please.
All right, we're talking about Pokemon that we catch. Now let's talk about types of Pokemon we can't catch. Things we have to fight and defeat, a.k.a. totem Pokemon.
Well, I have a big rant about why I hate Totem or Bombi.
All right. Please share.
Well, hopefully it's a big enough rant. Okay, so first of all, stats are up by 2 each. Ultra Necrozmas are only up by 1. Ultra Necrozma, the destroyer of the light of all the worlds, is like half as powerful as a B thing.
Don't see, it has power of the B movie.
Fire attacks are completely useless because there's Pelipper, which has Drizzle, and it's also holding the barrier that reduces fire damage. It has Bug Buzz, which is, of course, already a super powerful bug attack, boosted by two stages. Quiver Dance, which boosts its stats even more, which and Dazzling Gleam, also pretty powerful attack. It can summon Blissey, which has Heal Pulse.
It can?
Yeah. It has Heal Pulse.
Oh.
Yeah, I looked that up afterwards. I was like, oh, cool. He didn't summon that.
And Ribombee has Draining Kiss, too.
All right, so all these things you said, you're saying these are bad things?
It's just a little...
I mean, I like a challenge, but honestly, when I was fighting Totem Ribombee, it honestly felt really cheap. Like, I mean, I can... I'm fine if, like, fire attacks don't do damage, if it has a partner that heals, or if its stats are ridiculous, its attacks are ridiculous, but I think they could have easily... Well, they should have done without at least one of those things.
Here's totems are kind of inherently a little imbalanced because it's one Pokemon that's really strong, and they call upon new Pokemon. Normally, competitive battling feels at least somewhat fair because each of you have a full team of six. Even if you don't know what the other person's going to have, it can feel, you know, it's one-to-one. But with this, they have to make one really powerful Pokemon, but that asymmetry, asymmetric game design is really hard to do. Ask any developer who's tried to make a game with asymmetric game design. It's super challenging. So the fact that it's so powerful, they added so many things to make it, to make you actually lose that fight. Because the vast majority of people who play this game are not Nuzlockers. They don't design around Nuzlocks. So they want this to be a kind of fight where you do have to fight it over and over again. Because to them, that's actually makes it an actual difficult fight. Because that's not something we've really had in Pokemon before, where you have a real threat of being swept unless you impose rules on yourself. And the fact that you can never lose really in Pokemon means that the team decided to step up the difficulty a little bit, especially because Oras was such a pushover in terms of games, and a lot of people said that. I've kind of gone on a big tangent here. Point is it's hard to make a Pokemon where either you beat it immediately and it's a joke, or it destroys you, and then you have to just change your team to fit that specific Pokemon. With these totem Pokemon going into them, you aren't really sure what to expect beyond one of its typings, and so you can't really prepare for future things. You know what's already going to happen, which kind of takes the fun out a little bit, because for most people, I think, if you're not doing a Nuzlocke, what's going to happen is you're going to go in, you're going to lose, you're going to change your strategy now that you know what its strategy is, and you're going to go back in and you're going to beat it. Whereas in Pokemon, usually good design, and this is why people love Pokemon competitive battling so much, is you give it enough breathing room where it's 6v6, where no matter what you have, as long as your team is decently balanced and well put together, you can not have to rely on certain gimmicks to defeat it, where you can just have a good fair fight. That's kind of the end of my
game. I don't know. I'd hardly call plus two in each stat.
That's what I'm saying.
Plus more. And Ribombee is already fast as it is. With Quiver Dance.
What I'm saying is that it's hard to design something, because either Ribombee is going to be a joke, or it's going... if you have Stone Edge, okay? If you have a Alolan Dugtrio with Stone Edge, you use Stone Edge, you get a crit, both of them are down, you've won the fight, okay? That's all it is. Now, I didn't have Stone Edge because I had Shadow Claw, because I was expecting a Ghost Try beforehand and I never switched it off. So I did lose my Alolan Dugtrio during the fight. I'm kind of salty about that. But it's a very small percentage of us, like AB and I, both had a fight with with Ribombee where we lost a couple mons, but it was still a good fight. But it still did kind of feel cheap. Because even when we won, it still felt like I had to use X items personally. And that was the fight where I actually felt guilty about using so many X items. But there was no other way I could win. Even against the Ultra Necrozma, I didn't use that many X items. But I had to for her. for Bambi. The only other way I would have done it is let myself be swept and then just build a team specifically to counter the Bambi now that I know what it is. But that's...
All right, so Serp and Pip have anything.
After that long answer, I don't... after that long answer, I don't think I got anything.
I still think it's kind of stupid how the Destroyer of Worlds is weaker than a bee. I think that needs to be reiterated.
See, what they didn't show you is that off-screen, when it released all of its light, the Bambi was actually right nearby, and it absorbed, like, half of it. So the Cosmos light. And so that's why it's so powerful.
Okay.
For me, none of the
Coven... it's just the main character of the B-movie.
If you guys noticed, when freaking... he was talking over me at the time, but when Bambi appeared, I was like, "You like jazz?" But no one caught that. Sorry. I made a joke, and no one caught it.
I didn't know you said that, no.
No, because you were talking at the time. You were like, "Oh, it's a Bambi." I was like, "Ah, dang it."
Anyway. Guy Doc?
Yes, please.
All right. None of the totems in my run really gave me that much of a problem, other than Totem Araquanid, which is a totem that swept my whole team 3 times before I got lucky with a crit. So, Totem of Bambi, I got lucky with a crit with my Lopunny using Bounce.
Okay. So yeah, maybe it was not difficult for you.
Yeah, maybe I shouldn't even be talking. I froze Ultra.
Did he cut out? You cut out again?
He freezes.
As soon as he said freeze, you froze, dude.
This is the only time it's happened on this computer with this.
That's ridiculous.
My computer, right. Mic.
Anyway, as for my opinion, I thought every single totem was actually very fair and balanced, and you just have to think of the exact counter to whatever you're fighting. The problem is you might not have that in your party, and you may have to lose a couple members or maybe your whole team to get to use the correct counter.
Remember, AB, that in their game design when they're making this game, they don't think about you losing members.
No, I know. I'm not saying it in a bad way. Okay. I think it makes sense from their perspective in terms of, like, the every totem is, if you have the right thing to, like, to have a good thing against it, it's going to be not that difficult. At least in theory, you know. Then again, actually, that reminds me of something. Minette, you said that you killed Totem Togedemaru in one hit with your Alolan Dugtrio. I attacked Totem Togedemaru with my Alolan Dugtrio, and it didn't even do half. Are you sure we played the same game?
I might have gotten a crit, and I think my thing was adamant. I'm pretty sure.
Okay, if you got a crit, then fine. That answers that question.
I don't think you had Earthquake on yours.
No, I had Bulldoze. You had Earthquake? How did you have Earthquake?
Earthquake?
Yeah, how?
I might have to go back and check. I didn't record it, so I can't really check that way. Wait.
Right, that's fine. That's just something I've been meaning to talk about. I just thought of it now. Yeah. I just thought, you know, something to think about. All right. That's what all I had to say. I really enjoy the totem fights. I don't honestly know, though, if I like them more than gym leaders, though. I mean, they're really fun. Like, I really do enjoy them a lot. I just don't necessarily know if it's a better structure or the same or not really any different at all. Or I don't know. I don't know what to think, personally. Okay, I guess we're going to...
What, are we supposed to respond to that?
If you want to, you can. It doesn't matter. If you don't want to, that's fine.
I had Dig, not Earthquake.
Dig. Well, then if you digged once, then it would have called its partner during that turn when you were underground.
That is true. I don't know. I beat it in one turn. I remember that. Maybe okay. It's magnitude and got lucky. I just remember being really underwhelmed because I just...
Maybe it was like a magnitude 10. That's possible.
Yeah, that's possible. Yeah.
All right. I guess we're done with that now. I have no transition to this next topic, so I'll just get into it. Rotom!
Hello!
Sir, please explain why you like Rotom.
He's charming, I guess. That's basically it.
Okay, that's fine. Fair enough.
And I also like the map because I get lost really often in these sort of games, so... Yeah.
Okay.
I feel like... Rotom. He was
you like Rotom?
Okay.
Yeah.
It also makes you feel like you're like not like lonely all the time, you know.
He did say some charm.
I want to be by myself on my own adventure.
I feel like the areas where you had to click on it in order to progress was a bit much, maybe. I think he was a decent companion. I feel like had they put a little bit more work into him, into making him interesting and fun, just a little bit, it would have gone a long way. I also think that at least starting in post-game, we should have been able to disable him. I haven't played post-game yet, but everyone I know who's played a lot of post-game says he says like the same five things over and over again because there's nothing relevant for him to say in post-game.
He doesn't sign a moon, too, that post-game, at least. Like, you boot up the game, he says, like, one of five lines when you boot up the game, and that's, like, it. So,
I didn't play post-game that much, so I didn't really...
I'm indifferent to Roto.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I feel like I'll just repeat myself if I tell you why I don't like him, but I play through and all, but...
You can just easily just pull up the image I drew of you and Rotom, AB, and that trans explains it all in a nutshell.
Yeah, put it on screen right now.
Yeah, I am going to be putting images on screen while editing this, like, that goes along with what we're talking about at the time. I'll probably show that. if I have it still. It's online. I'm sure I'll find it. Anyway.
Yeah, it's on my DeviantArt.
Are you sure that when we say the game theory thing earlier, that you literally use the end title card for game theory? You better do that.
I don't know if I should do that. That's like their branding.
You do it in videos literally all the time. You will be.
You could just do a crappy MS Paint parody of it.
Yeah. I could do that.
Matt,
I think I'll do
would
that.
Not mind if somebody with 11,000 subscribers does that in a video, okay?
Just do an MS Paint parody, and it'll be Gucci.
Yeah, I'll do something like that, sure, maybe.
Yeah.
All right.
Put Moonset Dorn there for good measure.
Yeah, I'll show that right now. Anyway, Rotom, I just didn't like him because there was, like, either he was nothing on the bottom screen, or he was annoying, like, forcing me to press buttons to get him to stop talking. Whereas, I've been playing 6th Gen X and Y lately on live streams for my Y Dark monotype. The PSS, it pops up messages, but you can just press B and it cancels them. And also, you know what else the PSS does? It warns you when your battery is low. Does Rotom do that?
No.
No, Rotom does not do anything useful. He just asks you silly questions.
I'm so remembering the moment your DS died in the middle of Fire Emblem. You have to restart that whole level.
Yes, yeah.
I do like...
That's on YouTube right now.
I do like the way that Rotom looks just kind of casually being on the bottom screen, if that makes sense. I feel like...
like the design of him?
Yeah, because the PSS was kind of ugly, in my opinion. It just looked ugly.
I guess that's fair. I care more about functionality than I do design care more personally. About but
I just felt like it was worth noting. I can't. I want that. Here's what I'm most excited for. Actually, no, because it's not going to be any on a second screen on the Switch. We're never going to have that anymore.
That's actually an interesting topic.
We can never compare the bottom screens because, in my opinion, 4th Gen. If we always had a Poketch from then on, I would have been A-okay and just made every single other bottom screen a feature of the Poketch. Running tab, that's a feature. PSS, that's a feature. A Rotom Dex built into the Poketch, that's a feature. It would have been fine. Radio is a feature.
Would have been better than Festival Plaza.
Yeah, Festival Plaza is like the worst thing.
I don't even have that as a topic. I just completely forgot it was a thing in this game, to be honest.
It actually could have been.
Because it's unmemorable.
It could have been great. It could have been really, really fun.
I still don't know how to go and request battles with friends.
I feel like...
It's really complicated. Just click on them, battle them, that was it.
Yeah, I just thought of this. I feel like Festival Plaza is the perfect
analogy. Well, I'm lazy.
It's the perfect analogy for all of Sun and Moon and Ultra Sun and Moon, okay? There's some charm to it, and it can be a little flashy at times, and it can be, when it works, it can be fun, but... It's unnecessarily complicated. It's kind of slow and a little buggy and feels like it wasn't optimized well. And it feels like they tried to force things on you. And like they kept trying to force Festival Plaza on you. And there was just no substance there. There's no substance to it at all. And they try to make it seem like there's substance to it. Like, oh, look, all these things you can expand and you can talk to people. And look at all these lists. Don't you love all these lists that no one ever wants to use because it's so unnecessarily complicated? That felt like the entirety of Ultra Sun and Moon.
I guess that's correct. I would agree with that. Yeah.
And the fact that they had to force you to use one of their features in the Rainbow Rocket battle.
Rainbow Rocket. Oh, I guess that's a transition. Unless anyone has anything else to say about Festival Plaza.
I didn't that much. I liked Rainbow Rocket. I thought it was better than I expected because my expectations were absolute rock bottom, which is that this is going to be awful and be like the worst fan service. And what did they call that? And so when
pandering?
No, what's the word for when, fan fiction? That's it. Jeez. It was pandering fan fiction, but it wasn't terrible. It was fun. I had fun with it.
This plot line where Giovanni brings together all the evil team leaders is in a fan game I've seen once. I forget which one it is, but it's in one.
It seems like it would be.
It was kind of in my fan game, but I feel like I wrote it a lot better because it was a lot more complicated than just, oh, I got all the guys together. Now we're going to know. It was a lot more complicated than that. And Maxie and Archie weren't with them because Maxie and Archie had actually changed by the end of the...
I didn't like the repetitive grunt fights. Well, the repetitive grunt fights I didn't really like because, well, they're repetitive grunt fights.
Yeah, I feel like that's a problem of all evil teams. Oh, for the record, I didn't play Rainbow Rocket, so I have zero opinion on it.
Absolutely. Yeah, me neither.
It took me so long to beat Giovanni.
Giovanni, Nuzzle Sing Zap Togi the Maru.
The one, I wish I didn't waste my focus sash on Ultra Necrozma.
I think the little bits of dialogue that they gave to each head of the teams was well written, if that makes sense. It encapsulated who they were, and it actually didn't feel like awful pandery fan service-y thing that a 12-year-old would write. It felt cool. And it gave me nostalgia for the games, even for the games I didn't like.
Alright.
Each of the evil leaders, they came from a world where they actually succeeded, where there was no main protagonist to stop them.
Yes. And they conveyed that without forcing it down your throat, which is what they always do in writing in Pokemon games. It's because, they're a dumb little kid, they're not going to understand any nuance. No, they kind of sort of stated each of them that they succeeded, but they didn't say, I just swamped my world in ocean, and now I'm going to do the same thing here because I like water. No, it wasn't like that. They actually had some nuance to it.
Screw water. Delete all the water.
That's what Max said.
7.8 out of 10.
So one thing I also like is that they really kept Gus's true to his character in there, because he, just like in Black 2 and White 2, he tries to kill someone. He tried to kill Lily if he didn't back down. And
The classic versions of Archie and Maxie were how I remember the classic versions being, which wasn't a lot, but there was something there. And Cyrus was Cyrus. Giovanni was Giovanni. There's not much to these characters. So
I wish...
mess it up, I don't know. I guess it's not a big accomplishment, but I'm happy because I expected them to anyways.
I wish they had used Archie and Maxie's ORS design.
Well, it would make sense that they're from a different dimension, and Ruby and Sapphire was confirmed to be alternate realities to Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire.
Yeah, I kind of hate that, personally. Yeah. I'm not into the different dimensions, different times and stuff. I feel like that's just overcomplicating it, just to make the excuse, oh, we can do this because different dimensions. But that's just my opinion.
There's a game theory about that.
I'm fine with the two realities, because it explains Megas, it explains fairy typing and stuff.
It's a plot convenience.
I mean, it allowed them to make a departure in mechanics in 6th gen and allow them to remake more games and have it be okay.
Or they can just not talk about it and just remake the game. This is just a remake of that game. They don't need... I think it's unnecessary. I didn't think they needed to make the different dimensions thing. It's fine.
If they ever want to do any sort of plot connection at all in the future, then things would be super messy. And
I just don't think they should.
Maybe they shouldn't, but they want to keep the doors open, I think. They want to keep the possibility open.
Well, yeah, the possibilities are endless if you have different dimensions, alternate realities. That's why I feel like it's not a good excuse in my personal opinion, because there's no limits. There's no reason to have further explanation.
I do think they're just going to stick with two, though. Maybe, I don't know, if they want to make a huge another departure again, they might start a third one. But the fact that there's just the one... Where I mean, technically, there's there would be like, what, four of them at this point if we really wanted to go there. Because first gen didn't have steel typing, so that means second gen must be a different timeline if you really want to get technical with it.
Yeah, technically they did mention that because Bill and Gold Silver made the time capsule so you can send your Pokemon back in time to Red, Blue, and Yellow. You just can't have any of the new moves that are introduced in Gold, Silver, Crystal.
Yeah, I mean, that's just because those games take place to use afterwards. My personal opinion on the whole first and second are different timelines because Steel Type is new, is that they didn't acknowledge, like, Steel Type existed, they just didn't acknowledge it because they didn't realize it existed.
Yeah, it was newly discovered. Yeah, that was it. Newly discovered.
And the fact that the mechanics are different in battle is just our interpretation, because the characters in-game don't see a health bar for the Pokemon. They do in the anime, but not in the games. So it's just our interpretation is different. Our interpretation of what damage is being done is wrong, because the seal typing is there, we just interpret it weird. Which I feel like can be said for a lot of bugs in first gen to explain them conveniently. Sure. And we're super off-topic right now. I just like to point out.
Even Missing No?
Is Missing No have a canonical explanation by theorists?
Missing No is Giovanni's other son. Is Silver's brother. I just made that up right now.
It's Silver's brother, Platinum. Oh, wait.
That's already a game. That makes sense.
Is that in Light Platinum?
Is it? I don't know.
I'm just memeing.
Yeah. Okay. Well, while I just mentioned Light Platinum, I would like to point out Light Platinum is a terrible game. I don't know why people like that fan game, and it's terrible. Okay, move on.
I agree.
Light Platinum is not that bad.
Uranium was good, though.
Yes, it is.
Okay, now Light we're really getting off topic.
Yes, we are. I'm sorry. Next topic. I think we were on Rainbow Rocket. That was Rainbow Rocket, that topic. I hope you guys know. Anyway.
It was really more about...
Because AB, it was a rainbow. Well, we had to talk about every single Pokemon game colored version. We had to talk about everything because it's a rainbow.
Sure, I guess. Okay. Next topic is... SOS battles.
Look how they fixed SOS battles where it's not constantly when you're trying to catch Pokemon, they call about that part.
It took me so long to find a Marini.
I like it. I mean, I don't know if I'd say that. I feel like is too strong a word. I'm okay with it. I didn't dislike it. I know AB disliked it, but I didn't really mind it.
Yeah, it's only if you catch a Sableye in the game.
I did. Okay. It's okay when you want it to happen. It's not okay when you don't want it to happen. I don't know. I just really like horde battles.
I think that applies to everything.
They didn't like their replacement. That's all.
I mean,
they're a huge downgrade in my eyes.
I feel like it would take away some of the specialness of it. If you could only use an adrenaline orb to make it happen, because it's just kind of a post game feature. It's not even like something. And the fact that these Pokemon of Alola call upon each other, I think it's a cool thing because it's something that actual animals do, is call upon each other for help.
Okay, you can like it if you want.
And in terms of game design, it shows off lore and mechanics of the world. Like freaking Whistler calling a Marina. Marini, that's cool. That actually shows an interaction and a deeper interaction of these Pokemon through game design, which is what every game is trying to do. So I thought it was all right. Definitely think they improved it in this game because it's not as irritating. Pokemon...
Sure. I got nothing. Although it was very... It did make my experience trying to catch a Golett in Ultra Sun more frustrating than it needed to be.
But I am still salty. I spent 3 hours trying to catch a Marini with Merciless.
But it was worth it, right?
Yes, it was definitely worth it.
Okay, yeah. I don't know. I guess I'm alone in that thought then. I disliked them entirely. I do agree they were a little better in Ultra Sun, Ultra Moon because they weren't as annoying because they only called once unless you use an adrenaline orb. I didn't enjoy them. If you could maybe catch a Pokemon when there's still two out in the field, maybe I'd be okay with it. I don't do this anymore, but if I did want to do, say, shiny hunting or Eevee training, I would much rather do horde battles. There's so much more just sweet scent, kill the thing. Sweet scent, kill the thing. Or sweet scent, is there a shiny? No, run. Sweet scent, is there a shiny? No, run. Over and over, whereas SOS battles, use an adrenal lord. Hope he calls for help. Did he call for help? No. Attack him with false swipe. Did he call for help now? Yes, now he called for help. that I don't know. The process just seems more tedious. A lot less convenient for me. But maybe I shouldn't care because I don't do that stuff anymore. So I don't know.
Yeah, I prefer horde battles over to SLS battles anytime.
Well, if there's anything that's good that'll come out of this is that those who don't like it, it probably won't return because it was specifically mentioned to be an Alola thing. They say that several times. Two Pokemon and Alola are a lot more friendly with each other, so they call on each other for help. We probably won't see that again. That's probably a one-generation gimmick.
I hope so. I personally hope so.
But bring at the same time, swords. Maybe they'll bring back... I think the main excuse for this is because they first wanted to do Hordes, and then they were like, but that means there's going to be 6 Pokemon on the screen at one time.
Too much lag.
Guys, we can't handle 3. We can't handle 3 right now.
Yep, I theorized that during Sun and Moon. Or when technology is first playthrough. Correct. So maybe, okay. Anything else? I guess there's nothing else on that, unless someone has anything to add. Next thing. There's actually only a couple topics left. This next thing is probably my favorite feature of the game. How? I hear mixed opinions about how.
He's my favorite rival now.
I think he's good.
I liked him better in Sun and Moon, especially with his interaction with Faba.
What? That was just an interaction.
I think he's better.
I will also say I love the fact that he's champion in Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon at the end.
He's not really the champion.
Champion fight.
For all intents and purposes, he's the champion.
But I prefer how they had him in Sun and Moon when he was interacting with Faba about the whole thing. So if you see Hidden of the King, we can go any further.
Right, yeah. I did like some of his lines better in Sun and Moon.
I don't know why they got rid of that. But I do think he was a bit better in Usum because, I don't know, he actually beat Hala.
Yeah, I agree too. They made him out to be more of a strong rival character that's actually getting stronger and stronger as the game goes on, as opposed to just your friend who tags along, you know?
After I played the original Sun and Moon, my opinion was I don't like Hala that much. I don't play Leon that much. I love them together because they contrast so well with each other, and the dialogue with each other is one of the best parts of the dialogue of the game because one is so emo and the other is so bright and cheery, and they poke fun at each other. I feel like in Ultra Sun and Moon, have they developed that more where like they become good friends with each other and actually develop Gladion a little bit more? It would have been like the biggest improvement of the game. And then at the end, they're all like buddy-buddy with each other, but they also kind of not. They still like make fun of each other. That would have been like the best character dynamics of all time in Pokemon. But nah, they just... Gladion improved like 10%, and then Hoenn improved like a lot more than that.
And then everyone seems to forget that Gladion left on a boat or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he does come back, and it triggers a cutscene in post-game with Moan.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
If you wait a month and come back.
Huh.
So, yeah. One more thing about that whole... About how I am jealous his Pokemon follows him.
Yeah, he can have Pokemon outside of his ball. Why can't we?
Yeah, we should be able to have at least our starter outside of our ball.
And then if he dies, you don't have your follower anymore. Anyway, I guess that's it. I said this a lot in my playthrough, so this is probably repeating myself, but I loved how he is. I was trying to think if he was my new favorite rival or not, but I think he is not quite my favorite, only because he's in this game. That's honestly the only reason. If he was in a different game, honestly, he might be my favorite rival. But
I don't think that's a valid reason.
You don't think that's a valid reason?
No, I don't.
Okay. I can't... I guess I didn't really quite get this in this conversation yet, but I can't convince myself to replay these games. I don't see any... I've tried to already, and I'm bored in the first hour because I haven't played the game yet. I guess that's a transition to the next topic anyway, but... I have no way to experience how again. I don't want to get through all these cutscenes again.
I'll tell you what, AB, if I ever actually get around to finishing my fan game, I'll put Hoenn there for you.
Oh,
make him a cameo.
Huh. Sure, yeah, that would make him my favorite ride. Okay.
Yeah, like he'll play a fan game, especially after Insurgent.
Hey, I'm going to try Uranium after Y is done.
No fan games are good. Only my fan game is ever going to be good.
Oh, wow. All right.
Well, you've seen me play Uranium before, and you like it from what I showed you, right, AB?
It was like 10, 15 minutes, wasn't it? You just like found a couple wild Pokemon. Yeah, I don't know if that's enough to really get a full opinion on it, but...
I take back what I said before. Sage is going to be good. When Sage finally comes out, I've played the demo for Sage. Sage is actually a good Pokemon game. It might actually be better than some of the main series Pokemon games. I did not expect 4chan to make such a good game. Jeez.
And then there was 4chan's other fan game, which was a ROM hack called Pokemon
Clover. Which is Clover.
Oh god, that game.
No, but if you guys haven't played the demo for Sage, I know that AB is waiting for the full release, which I think is later this year. I could be wrong about that. I know that they've designed the Elite Four. They might be doing post-game right now, but...
This is very off-topic.
Yeah, it is.
It's fine. I don't care.
Anything to prolong the podcast.
More ass!
This has already gone longer than I thought it would, to be honest.
If you don't like fan games, just give the demo for Sage a try, please. It's actually legitimately amazingly good.
Who knows? You might end up cutting all this out.
No, I don't know. But anyway, okay, just back to how.
I thought we were done with how.
How do we keep getting off topic?
There is not much more to say, is there? I guess I was trying to defend my opinion of him, but I guess I really can't. He's just so close to being my favorite rival, just not quite. That's saying a lot though, because, I feel like it's saying a lot, isn't it? He's almost my favorite rival.
I feel like they could have still developed him slightly more. I mean, you could say that about basically any character. He has these interactions with Guzma towards the end, which I think were kind of charming. They were kind of heartwarming. I feel like there wasn't any build-up to them, though, because they didn't really fit. What he said fit with his character, but the context didn't really fit, if that makes sense.
All right, well, that leads us to... I did have Gladion as a topic, but I didn't feel there was much to say about him. I kind of skipped over that. So unless someone has anything notable to say...
To really say is that... His dialogue is better in Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon, even though his presence in the story is arguably not.
Yeah.
He was wasted potential, I think.
Because of all the stuff with Lusamine.
I think they actually could... It would have been so easy to make him so much better, and at least in my opinion. Because they showed a thing with like him taking over... What's it called? The Ether. They could have pushed that a little bit more. They could have made that a little bit more into his character.
Yeah, and like take on more responsibility.
Yeah,
and like
take on more responsibility. You know. Could have, or as I mentioned before, they could have played him off of Howe a little bit more and developed them as friends. There was just and all the like little actions and little dialogue he said just could have been improved so much. Like him battling you, they could have actually made that make sense. And, I don't know. I feel like if they just had. If only they had my amazing writing skills on this team.
Oh my god. I'm
great. I'm one. Okay, enough shameless plugs.
I am serious though, in that the Game Freak doesn't really write stories. They do need some kind of writer because they don't have one. It's kind of evident when they try to write anything and nothing is ever good.
All right. I guess that is kind of going into the next and sort of final topic, sort of, but not really, because the last one's more of an encompassing all thing. But this is we've talked about it before this recording started a little bit, and this is the literal reason I cannot bring myself to replay these games. It is the cutscenes. Mm-hmm. They take up more than half of the game in my just thinking about it. Honestly, if it wasn't for them, all these previous flaws we just talked about, I feel like they wouldn't bother me as much, because, I don't know, because I'm just playing through all these freaking cutscenes, and this is what I get for sitting through all this. It doesn't amount to anything super great or super groundbreaking. The cutscenes would be forgivable if it was really well written and there were all these amazing things after it, but there isn't, in my opinion. So...
Okay. Yeah, the moment that cutscenes played, the only ones I truly liked were the ones on the Altar of the Sun or the Altar of the Moon. First with showing that Lusamine failed, stopping Necrozma, the whole fight of Necrozma versus Sogalia or Lunazza, depending on what game you play. And also
ones were fine, yeah. Well, anything with Howe I was also fine with, but... Yeah, major stuff and stuff with Howe was fine. Everything else was just a slog.
Hey, kid, you want to learn how to use the Poke Finder?
Let's get something out of the way right now. The actual facts around the cutscenes, okay? The average time and the median time to play this game is 30 hours. Now, if you're a slower reader, the cutscenes are going to take you 6 hours. If you're an above average reader, it's going to take you more like 4. If you're literally jamming through it as fast as possible in a speedrun, it's going to take you
four
over 3
hours.
Even if you go as fast as humanly possible, over 3 hours is going to be cutscene. And the other 3 hours in that same speedrun is also 3 hours. It's literally over half the game in terms of bare bones content, which is ridiculous, especially because they force on you, as I used in my analogy earlier, they force on you and there's nothing really of substance there. It's just not good. It's not terrible. It's not all plot holes. It's not like it's atrocious. But it's just not enjoyable, at least for most people. Maybe to little kids, enjoyable, because they don't know any better, because they're a little kid. But they're just not good.
I would also say that if I only played through the games once, like if I was someone who only played through games once, then I could sort of see it, because I just play through it, and this is new to me. I'm seeing all these cutscenes, and then the game's over. Okay, I'm done. That was a fun game. But then I'm not one of those people, though. I replay them over and over to do challenges. I can't bring myself to replay these games because of all this stuff.
This goes back to our previous topic of, here's the thing is, you can't, they can't even make that excuse, because this is the second time we're playing through the exact same story, or almost the exact same story.
90% the same story.
90% the same story. And so they can't just say, well, is it just meant to be played once? No. A, because replay value is a huge aspect of game development, and B, you just gave us the same game again. You can't say that when you literally sell the same game 4 times. Okay, let's just get this out of the way too. 4 times, not even just twice, because it's 2 versions of each game that are each 98% the same to each other. They could have made the games better. My idea for the game would have been, in one game, Necrozmus stole the word's light, and you have to get your own world's light back. In the other game, they stole the light. It stole the light from the Ultra Recon Squad's world, and so they came to you because Ultra Necrozma came to your world, and now the world is super bright. So it's never nighttime in your world, but on their time it's dark because Ultra Necrozma's now in your world. And the plot would have been slightly different.
That's an interesting idea.
Yeah, it would have been really cool.
Yeah, what you said, that would have made the games a heck of a lot better. In my opinion, the only second version game, Emerald, Platinum, and all them, has to be Black and White because they actually continue the story.
Yeah, those weren't the same.
Those are actually sequels.
Those are sequels. They're completely different. They're not even comparable. There's a difference between a sequel and a remake. A remake immediately after the game was released. That's what these are.
Why don't they just release more sequels?
I wouldn't be surprised at all if they started development on Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon during 2017 sometime.
You had a theory earlier about how it might have gone on the Switch.
Yeah.
I'm thinking just the opposite, that they knew the 3DS's lifespan was coming to an end, so they wanted to rush the final Pokemon game on it out the door so they can begin working on Switch stuff.
They've been working on the Switch game for a long time though, haven't they?
I think they only started development on whatever Pokemon game is coming to Switch like in the spring of last year.
Well, whatever the game it is, it better be good.
In the summer.
No, they started...
sure it'll be at least good.
Because they split the team. What they did is, we have confirmation of this part, is that they split the team into when they started development on Ultra Sun and Moon, and the older guys worked on the Switch version, and the newer guys worked on Ultra Sun and Moon.
Oh, that explains all the newbies.
Yeah.
Anyway.
The newbies don't know how to make a good Pokemon game.
That's... I can't remember his name, Johnny something. There's only one veteran on that team. All the other veterans went to the work on the Switch, which hopefully means that the Switch game is going to be good. Hopefully.
All right, but anyone else to add anything about cutscenes? I guess the only thing I'll quickly add is that if there was a skip button, I would be totally fine replaying these games.
I would be too.
I think it was absolutely ridiculous how a quarter of the game was all tutorial.
Yeah. Basically,
one thing I wish is that they have an option to where you say if you're a seasoned Pokemon trainer or if you're a new Pokemon trainer, that way you can skip those stupid.
Yeah, like
and you can switch.
Come out in the past year, I'm sorry, that's asking too much, Pip. That is asking way too... A feature that's in almost every single other AAA game? No. Game Freak can't do that. Skipping cutscenes? What is this? 2018? 2017?
Yeah, exactly.
Hindsight is 2020.
So is the year that we'll actually get Skipple Girl cutscenes in a Pokemon game.
Hopefully.
All right, well, that was my last topic on my list, so my last thing would just be if anyone has overall thoughts of the thing game as a whole and where it places on their ranking of their favorite Pokemon games or any other final closing thoughts.
Sun and Moon, Gen 7 in total, I like them, but it's just Ultra Sun and Moon,
Yeah,
Ultra really need to exist.
Gen 7, they're good games in their own right. I like how they were trying the new thing of adding new Pokemon for Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon. The rehash, it could have been better just being DLC. Gen 6, in my opinion, is just my third favorite gen behind Hoenn and...
I'm going to be honest, I can't remember anything about Gen 6.
No, Gen 6 was just like the test gen, in my opinion. It's what I thought. Yeah. It's what I thought when I first started playing, because I didn't even play it for a while. When I saw Aquablade's playthrough out of it on Twitch, I thought, these look like test games. And I think they were. I think they really were test games, because they had all these little features that they didn't really expand on.
Yeah. Well, it is called Pokemon X and Y.
Yeah, people are still mad, salty that there's no Z for Zygarde.
Yeah.
But...
It would have been like just like Ultra Sun, Ultra Moon, the same game but tiny tweaks.
Yeah.
That's precisely why I actually didn't want Z, because it would have been that. And why I thought... it was actually a theory I had as to why they didn't make Z, because I thought, oh, Gen 5 was the one right before Gen 6. Oh, they're going to do that from now on. They want to make sequel games that are like completely different
and put a lot more work into.
And you know, they didn't do that. They I was completely wrong. They just decided not to do Z for one reason or another. Then they did... Exactly that, though, for the Ultra games.
They could have made a math joke and had it be X squared and Y squared, and it would have been great.
Yeah, that would have been fine, too, if it was like sequels and stuff.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure Z didn't release was because they were trying to rush out Sun and Moon for, like, Pokemon's anniversary.
That could also be it.
Yeah, weren't Sun and Moon and X and Y in development at the same time?
Yes, they were. Sun and Moon were like, the longest developed Pokemon shifty. Games.
Oh.
Yes,
not that it shows.
Yeah, I was about to say.
I would say...
I'm going to stand by my opinion that Gen 5 was the best.
Yeah, I agree. Gen 5 was the best. I think Sun and Moon... I like the ideas they had with Sun and Moon. I still think they're solid games. I'd probably place them somewhere in the middle. But yeah, the execution... it wasn't the best...
Ultra Sun and Moon, Sun and Moon in general, towards the bottom for me. I'm not going to talk about my whole list because I know I will take up a whole nother hour just talking about the aspects of game design.
Yes, please.
But,
make your own video about this.
I feel like if everybody here has given their thoughts on where it is, I would like to sort of talk about overall the shift in tone that is kind of happening with Pokemon. I mentioned this earlier because there's a bunch of shifts in tone in Pokemon with Sun and Moon. I think almost everyone can agree on that. The directions that they're going with Pokemon is very different. And so the question, I have a couple questions about it for you guys to answer so that you guys can talk about questions I have. Do you think that these shifts in tone are just an Alola thing just for these games? Or is Pokemon going to continue to go in this direction of heavy cutscenes and maybe something more like totem fights instead of gym leaders, maybe something completely different? Do you think many of the weird new features in Gen 7 are going to stick around or not? Do you think Z moves are still going to be a thing, or is it just kind of be shunted to the side like Mega Evolution?
I do think they will be, it will be passed along the side, and they'll introduce a new gimmick for Gen 8 and that they will also toss aside after that.
Yeah,
if they keep this up, then they might not be able to support the old ones anymore because there's so much that they need to support.
I mean, if they do nothing with Megas and triple battles and rotation battles, then I don't see they would do something with all the mechanics they introduced in Gen 7.
Well, they had to keep the Z moves because I think it's the Z move is the only way for you to get Ultra Necrozma.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That is true. How would they do that? I wonder how they would do that. Or maybe they just wouldn't have them in the game. Because, like, there are some forms, I feel like, that are in some games that you can't transfer because they didn't create the data for them. It's like those forms of Pichu in Gen 4, as well as, I believe, Cosplay Pikachu and from Oras cannot be transferred. That just might be Pokemon that you can no longer get.
Which like, might make sense in terms of competitive battling, because otherwise they could have some serious power creep issues. I mean, Mega Rayquaza was insane enough as it is. If that's just unobtainable in the future, that could be...
Who knows, they might scrap Megas entirely.
I don't know what they're going to do, but... my theory actually for the Switch game is I think they're going to do something completely different. Not Sun and Moon different, but even more different. Just with the pattern they've been doing with Switch games, with like Zelda Breath of the Wild and Mario Odyssey, kind of like
an open world Pokemon game.
I'm serious. I think it's going to be something completely different, but still sort of Pokemon. I could be wrong. That's just my theory, though.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. It's a sequel to XD. Yeah, I just lose my mind. You guys would not.
I honestly kind of hope that the new Switch game is PokéPark 3.
What?
No, I'd actually really like that.
I've never played those games.
Called PokéPark Resort. They're really
fun. I've seen
fun,
a playthrough.
Even though they're
though.
For 2-year-olds.
Oh, you like them?
I like them.
I know, I'm really a good. Mystery dungeon.
That's what really I was just thinking that too. A new mystery dungeon on this, which is going to be fun.
Hopefully,
we're getting really off topic. Now.
Mystery dungeon can be a different topic for a different day.
None of you really answered my questions about the shifts in, like, not just the shifts in battle mechanics and that stuff. That's kind
right,
of
you
like
did list a lot of questions. So,
wrapping this up here, what should we wrap it with? I got wrapping paper.
I didn't say my closing. I didn't say my closing thoughts.
Yeah, go ahead, AV, and then we
go
can.
Ahead, go ahead.
Okay, they're my least favorite games of Pokemon. Okay. I've said this before. They're not. I would not call them bad games, but they're the ones I want to play the least, and that's really all it comes down to. When it comes to game, I think about, oh, I want to play that game. How much I want to play? I want to replay them the least of all of them. So that is all there is to it, because of all the reasons I just said. Mostly the cutscenes. Everything else is worse because of the cutscenes.
Yeah, I was talking to you about this a little while ago. I was having trouble with the time. I've since defined my list because I've played through some of the games. They are my second least favorite. The only one being worse being Pokemon Y, which I still haven't finished. I own it and haven't finished it. I finished Sun and Moon and Ultra Sun and Moon. The fact that I can't finish Y should be a testament of how poorly I think of it.
Yep, that makes sense. I guess that is... I think that's the end. So, I guess thank you all for watching, or listening, more rather. Let me know what you thought of this, if you have any suggestions for future ones. A suggestion I can already tell might be cut off Minette sometimes.
Yeah. You gotta start somewhere.
I probably like 70% of the podcast. I'm just gonna skip through it and be like, who's this guy keeps talking?
I might honestly cut out some of your tangents, but we'll see.
Objection.
We'll see when I'm rewatching through it. Anyway, and feel free to suggest future topics. I already have a couple in mind, I won't spoil what they are, actually. And maybe if no one liked this video, then I probably won't do them, but whatever. Either thank you all for watching. I hope you enjoyed. And as always,
rock on.
Rock on.
Iron off.
That's what we do.
Yeah, rock on.
Yeah, hopefully OBS won't cut me out.
Cut this out. I dare you.